Hi, everyone, and welcome to this virtual program, Washington's Undiscovered Feminists, with speaker Mayumi Tsutakawa. I'm Heather Marker from the Seattle Public Library. As we begin today, I would like to acknowledge that those of us here in Seattle are gathered on the ancestral land of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders, past and present, and thank them for their stewardship of the land. Thanks so much for tuning in this morning with this morning's program, which is presented in partnership with Humanities Washington. The presentation you're about to enjoy is part of Humanities Washington's Speakers Bureau program. Humanities Washington is a nonprofit organization dedicated to sparking conversation and critical thinking, and provides cultural programs to hundreds of thousands of people throughout the state of Washington each year. To learn more, please visit their website at www.humanities.org. Today, after the presentation portion of the program, we'll have time for your questions. You can submit questions at any time during the program. Just type them in the chat box in the right side of your WebEx screen. We may not have time for all the questions, but we'll get to as many as we're able. I'd also like to note that this program is being recorded and will be posted to the library's YouTube channel at a later date. And now, I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker. Mayumi Tsutakawa is an independent writer and curator who has focused on Asian Pacific American history and arts. Tsutakawa received her MA in communications and her BA in East Asian Studies at the University of Washington. She co-edited the book, The Forbidden Stitch, an Asian American Women's Literary Anthology, which won the Before Columbus America's Foundation's American Book Award. She is also a contributor to the recently published book, Spirited Stone, Lessons from Kubota's Garden, which you can find at and borrow from the Seattle Public Library. Tsutakawa is a longtime resident of Seattle, and we are honored to have her with us today. Please welcome Mayumi Tsutakawa.
Hey everyone, and can we start the PowerPoint first slide? Wonderful. It's great to be here on this really beautiful morning, and I want to thank the Seattle Public Library, and in particular Heather and the staff in the History, Travel, and Maps Department for this really great opportunity to share this information. And I also want to note that I enjoyed giving a talk last February to people who were present in the Seattle Public Library Auditorium. And last February, that talk was about my father, George Tsutakawa, who created the fountain in front of the downtown library building. So as you'll see, there are a couple of questions at the bottom of the first slide. And we, for Humanities Washington, we like to pose questions. What defined feminism 100 years ago as compared to today? And how does your cultural heritage affect your definition of feminism? So I hope that by the end of this talk, you might think about those questions, and I'll pose them again, and you can answer them. And we can have a discussion, or we don't have to talk about those if you have so many other burning questions or examples of from your life and so on. So thank you to Humanities Washington for presenting me. This is the last week of my four-year term with Humanities Washington as a speaker. And I also want to note that Humanities Washington is supported by the National Endowment for the Humanities. So if you ever get a chance to talk with your congressional representative, please urge that person to support the budget for the National Endowment for the Humanities. First of all, for myself, I want to acknowledge that we are settled on land that is part of a Native American legacy dating back 10,000 years in the Pacific Northwest. And this year is the 100th anniversary of the ratification of the right to vote for women nationally. And today I will present to you stories of women in arts and journalism in Washington State in the early 20th century. And they were pioneers pathfinders, and breakers of stereotypes. I'd like to focus on the 1920s and 30s, the pre-war period, as a formative time for the communities across the Pacific Northwest. And I want to encourage a comparison of the political forces affecting women while sharing stories between cultural communities and recognizing women's lives across generations. In the humanities, we use historical records to study people's lives and accomplishments. And the influences on these women's lives were many. The arc of history, world wars, control by patriarchal institutions, the church and the state, the family structure, conflicting points of view between foreign-born parents and their American-born offspring. And these resulted in controls on the right to vote, to work outside the home, to marry whom one wanted to divorce and remarry, or to not marry at all. 100 years ago, it was daring and even dangerous for women to speak out, to publish their writing and photographs, to examine gender discrimination, and to work outside the home for their own income. Okay, next slide. So since this is a Seattle audience, some of you might recognize, I can't use my cursor to show. Let's just say I'm in one of these photographs taken from in the 1970s in demonstrations in the International District of Seattle. The photo on the left is the demonstration against the building of the King Dome. Maybe some of you were there. And the one on the right is the demonstration for low-income housing for elders in the International District, and these were in 1972. Surely some of you might possibly remember and recognize the images. In the photo on the right, on the bottom in front is Roberto Maestas, the head of El Centro de la Raza, and in the upper right-hand side is Salmi Domingo, who is the head of the cannery workers union, who sadly was assassinated. And next to him, the short-haired lady, that's me. Okay, women's history has been one of my passions through activism, writing, and creating art exhibitions. Since the 1970s, I have presented the history of women of color and women in the arts to my community and the public. I began my activist career within the progressive movement in Seattle and helped to organize a study group called Seattle Third World Women. I was in many activist protests in the International District and at the University of Washington as president of the Asian Student Coalition. I spoke out at huge rallies against the bombing of Cambodia. And just last year, I visited Cambodia for the first time, and I was saddened to note that there are still people who are suffering from the terrible regime of the Khmer Rouge in the 1970s. Later, as a writer for the Seattle Times, I covered the early feminist movement in Washington State and was the primary reporter covering the Washington Women's Conference, which was held in Ellensburg in 1977. Maybe some of you know about it or were there. And the National Women's Conference held in Houston in 1977. This is where the famous ERA, Equal Rights Amendment, was encouraged for adoption across as a national platform. And of course, you might know that the ERA has still not been passed ratified in the United States. I also co-edited two anthologies of women of color writings, Gathering Ground, which was called New Writing and Art by Northwest Women of Color from the Seal Press in Seattle, and The Forbidden Stitch, Asian American Women's Literary Anthology from Calix, a feminist press in Oregon, and that was the first national Asian American women's literature anthology. Okay, next slide. Suffrage. The word suffrage comes from ancient the ancient Latin word suffragium, or a petitioner's prayer on behalf of others. The right to vote, called women's suffrage, was new to many parts of the United States when the federal government passed the constitutional amendment granting women the right to vote in 1920. So we're celebrating that centenary this year. But in Washington state, the all-male legislature voted to give women suffrage in our state first in 1883, and then on a technicality voted again in 1888 to give women the right to vote. Imagine, this was only 20 years after Seattle was incorporated as a town with a tiny population of 1,000. Then legal maneuverings set the vote aside, and finally by popular statewide vote, the state constitution was amended to give Washington women the vote in 1910. So that was clearly far before the national ratification in 1920. Thus, Washington became the fifth state in the entire nation to provide the right to vote to women. And what were the previous four? Not states with big urban centers like New York, California, or Illinois. They were Colorado, Idaho, Utah, and Wyoming, and Washington. So at the end, maybe you have some ideas or answers to the question of why these five states would encourage the vote for women. And every step along the way, there were political battles inspired by national women suffrage speakers like Susan B. Anthony, who spoke here in Washington in 1871, and with committees of women, hearings, lobbying, leaflets, and marches. And these are all the same things we do today to achieve political change. Okay, next slide. The notion of feminism is the key building block in raising women to achieve these steps of change, like the right to vote. Feminism is a whole range of political movements, ideologies, and social movements that share a common goal. And that goal is to define and achieve political, economic, and personal equality of the sexes. This includes seeking to establish educational and professional opportunities for women that are equal to those for men. Feminist movements have campaigned and continue to campaign for women's rights, including the right to vote, to hold public office, to work certain jobs, to earn fair wages or equal pay, to own property, to receive an education, to enter contracts, to have equal rights within marriage, and to have maternity leave. Feminists have also worked to ensure access to legal abortion and to protect women and girls from rape, sexual harassment, and domestic violence. Changes in dress and acceptable physical activity, like sports, have often been part of feminist movements around the world. Okay, slide. Today I'd like to present to you the lives of diverse Washington pioneer women of that pre-war period 100 years ago. And then you will decide if their interesting lives and achievements amount to feminist acts. Imogene Cunningham, a photographer and chemist. Priscilla Chong Ju, an artist and shop owner. Vi Hilbert, a Native American language preservationist. Anna Louise Strong, a pro-communist journalist. And Ruby Bishop, a jazz singer and pianist. Next slide. Imogene Cunningham, a celebrated photographer, was born in Portland in 1883. She was the fifth of 10 children. She grew up in Seattle, and in 1901, at the age of 18, Cunningham bought her first camera, a 4x5-inch view camera. She entered the University of Washington, which had been founded 40 years before, and with the help of her chemistry professor, she began to study the chemistry behind photography, and she subsidized her tuition by photographing plants for the botany department, such as this photo of the succulent here. In 1907, Cunningham graduated from the University of Washington with a degree in chemistry. And after graduation, Cunningham went to work for the famous photographer Edward S. Curtis in his Seattle studio, learning the portrait business and practical photography. Cunningham worked on the Curtis project of documenting American Indian tribes for his famous set of large format books, The North American Indian, which was published between 1907 and 1930. And Cunningham learned the technique of platinum printing under Curtis's supervision and became fascinated by that process. In 1909, Cunningham was awarded a graduate fellowship to study at the Technische Hochschule in Dresden, Germany, where she helped the photographic chemistry department find cheaper solutions for the expensive platinum used for printing. Okay, next slide. At the age of only 27, Cunningham opened her own studio in Seattle and won acclaim for her portraits, such as this one. Most of her portrait work consisted of sitters in their own homes, or in her living room, or in the woods surrounding Cunningham's cottage. And I believe that cottage was adjacent to the Arboretum, which became a great setting for her photos. She became a sought-after photographer and exhibited at the Brooklyn Institute of Arts and Sciences in 1913. The next year, she married Roy Partridge, a teacher and an artist. And between 1915 and 1920, Cunningham continued her work and had three children. In 1920, the family moved to San Francisco. Cunningham refined her style, taking a great interest in pattern and detail and becoming increasingly interested in botanical photography. Then she once again changed direction, becoming more interested in the human form, particularly hands, and she was fascinated with the hands of artists and musicians. This led to her employment by Vanity Fair magazine, the same Vanity Fair magazine that we have today, and she was famous for photographing movie stars without their makeup, which was quite a scary thing back then. In 1934, Cunningham was invited to work in New York for Vanity Fair magazine. Her husband wanted her to wait until he could travel with her, but she refused, and they divorced that year. In 1945, Cunningham was invited by Ansel Adams to accept a position as a faculty member for the Art Photography Department at the San Francisco Art Institute. In the 1950s and 60s, she continued her nature photography work with other leading photographers such as Edward Weston, who created a large set of photographs of Yosemite National Park. And Cunningham died in 1976 at age 93, just after her work was exhibited at a major photography festival in France. And I found out only recently that her archives are stored by her granddaughter on Lopez Island. Okay, next slide. Priscilla Chong-Ju was a fiber artist and a gallery shop owner. And this, if you can see it, the slide on the right, this photo on the right, is this really cool photo of Priscilla as a child with her sisters riding a horse in Olala, Kitsap Peninsula. Priscilla Chong was a fiber artist and gallery shop owner. Priscilla Huang, her name then, was born in 1916 on the Kitsap Peninsula in the town of Fragaria, which she loved to remind us that the word Fragaria is the Latin name for a strawberry. Her parents had no, and this town of Fragaria is right by Olala. In case you know that area, it's the coastline that faces the west side of Gashan Island. Her parents had no idea of English names, and so their older daughter asked her school teacher for a name, and thus came Priscilla. Her father was a Baptist minister from the Guangdong region of southern China and a very early Chinese convert to the Baptist faith. The family came to Seattle in 1909, right at the time of the Alaska-Yukon Pacific Exposition, a very large, fancy, temporary construction of an international fair on the UW campus. This is after the UW moved from downtown up to Montlake. Priscilla's mother, the daughter of a dry goods shop owner in China, was quite the entrepreneur, and she looked around at all these potential customers at the exposition and decided to open a shop in downtown Seattle, bringing over embroidered clothing and gift items from China. So some of you may remember the Frederick and Nelson department store. The shop was right around the corner from Frederick and Nelson. By 1931, the family opened another shop with Chinese goods as part of the Western Washington Fair at Puyallup. And Priscilla ran it by herself from the time she was a teenager for 30 years. The family also managed a Chinese gift shop as part of the Seattle World's Fair in 1962. She says her mother did not speak much English, but was great with customers, good-tempered and hardworking. And during the Depression, the family ate a lot of sautéed peanuts and lettuce over rice. We could buy 5 heads of lettuce for a dime at the end of the day, she said. But after that, I could never eat cooked lettuce again. Okay, next slide. Priscilla married the noted Chinese artist Fei Chong, who helped to organize exhibitions of the Chinese Painters Club in Seattle's International District. And she developed fabric designs and exhibited and sold them. I believe in this photo, these are tie-dye artwork. That's her in the middle and Faye on the right. Her textile designs included block prints, tie-dye, weaving, and batik. And she exhibited her work at the early Bellevue Arts and Crafts Fair with her husband, Faye, who showed his paintings. The couple had 3 children. And after Fei Chong died suddenly at the age of 61, Priscilla married Willard Ju, a noted Chinese community historian and herbalist. Unfortunately, Willard died just shortly after in 1984. Even into her 80s, Priscilla Chong Ju's interests included, besides her artwork, she was involved in designing and constructing parade floats and costumes for the University District Parade. She was active in ice skating and Hawaiian dance, and she died in 2012 at the age of 96. Okay, next slide. Vi Hilbert. Vi Hilbert was a Native American language preservationist. She was born Vi Anderson, a member of the Upper Skagit tribe, in 1918, near the small town of Lyman, Skagit County. Her father was a master canoe maker and a champion canoe racer. He and her mother spoke the Lushootse, or Puget Salish language. This is the language of Chief Self, whom Seattle was named after. As the family moved from one town to another, often as fruit pickers, her mother coaxed stories out of the native people, and Vi learned and treasured these stories. After attending so many schools, she opted to enroll in the Indian boarding school in Salem, Oregon, and then finish high school there. She eventually married 3 times and had 3 children, 2 of whom survive. Her many jobs in Washington also included ironing, housework, running a pool hall and cafe, processing pears in a cannery, a stock clerk, a cookie wrapper for a Danish bakery, an electric welder at Todd Shipyards, cashiering at a food wagon at Boeing, a secretary at Children's Orthopedic Hospital, and a hairdresser. Okay, next slide. In 1967, she met and agreed to help the linguist Thomas Hess transcribe and translate the early Lushootse recordings of elders. She learned to read and write this language, which she had only learned as an oral language, and eventually taught the Lushootse language and traditional stories at the University of Washington. UW Press published three of her books. Then she established her own publishing house, Ushutseed Press, to continue publication of her many volumes of native language books, such as stories and dictionaries. Bai Gilbert taught for 15 years at the UW and 3 years at Evergreen College, and many of her students became Ushutseed teachers. She shared her native traditions with institutions such as the Burke Museum, the Seattle Art Museum, United Indians of All Tribes, and she received many awards, including a national award from the National Endowment for the Humanities. Bai Hilbert spoke Ushutseed with every audience she addressed, especially traditional gatherings, so that this ancient language can still be heard throughout Puget Sound, where it has been spoken for centuries. Bai Hilbert passed away at her home in Laconer in 2008 at the age of 90. Next slide. Anna Louise Strong is one of the most notable radical women journalists in the history of the United States. She was born in Nebraska in 1885, the daughter of middle-class liberals who were active in missionary work and the Congregational Church. A gifted child, she raced through public school, then studied languages in Europe. She graduated from Bryn Mawr College, did graduate work at Oberlin, and at age 23, earned her PhD from the University of Chicago. As an advocate for child welfare for the United States Education Office, she organized an exhibition and toured it extensively throughout the United States and abroad. When she brought it to Seattle for 6 months, starting in May 1914, it attracted more than 6,000 visitors per day, many of them women. Unable to find solutions for the needs of underprivileged children and the working class, Strong concluded that capitalism was at fault and became an avowed socialist. She was 30 years old when she returned to Seattle to live with her father, the Reverend Sidney Strong, pastor of Queen Anne Congregational Church. She favored the Seattle political climate at the time, which was pro-labor and progressive. She also enjoyed mountain climbing and led climbing parties on Mount Rainier. When Strong ran for the Seattle School Board in 1916, she won easily, thanks to support from women's groups and organized labor and her reputation as an expert on child welfare. And she was the only female board member. She argued that the schools should offer social service programs for underprivileged children and that they should serve as community centers, but the other school board members did not agree. In the year of her election to the school board, in 1916, the Everett Massacre occurred. Strong was hired as a stringer, or a reporter, by the New York Evening Post to report on the bloody conflict between the International Workers of the World Union, which we call the Wobblies, and the Army of Armed Guards hired by Everett mill owners to keep them out of town. At first an impartial observer, she soon became an impassioned spokesperson for workers' rights. Strong's endorsement of controversial liberal causes set her apart from her colleagues on the school board. She opposed war as a pacifist, and when the United States entered World War I in 1917, she spoke out against the draft. On the one hand, the PTA and women's clubs joined her in opposing military training in the public schools. On the other hand, groups of military veterans branded her as unpatriotic. Strong's fellow school board members were quick to launch a recall campaign against her, and they won by a narrow margin. Strong became more openly associated with the liberal press, writing forceful pro-labor articles and promoting the new Soviet government. In 1919, 2 days before the beginning of the Seattle General Strike, she proclaimed her support for the strike, which ended as it had begun peacefully and with its goals still largely undefined. So disillusioned with the indecision of the labor movement, Strong began to travel as a foreign correspondent for radical American newspapers. Okay, next slide. I was excited to discover this photo on the left here. It's Anna Louise Strong, and just to the right of Chairman Mao is W.E.B. Du Bois in China in 1959. Du Bois was a great, great scholar. In the late 1920s and into the early 1930s, Strong ventured into China, parts of Asia, and throughout the Soviet Union, interviewing ordinary workers and people in the street, as well as senior Soviet leaders. She visited Spain in 1937 during the Spanish Civil War, and she accompanied the Soviet Red Army as they were victorious in Poland and in Berlin in 1945. And she visited China during the latter stages of the War of Liberation in 1949. After World War II, Strong was arrested in the U.S. on espionage charges. But she was freed, and after another visit to the USSR, that's the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, in 1955, she settled in China in 1958 at the age of 72, where she was one of the few Western journalists to gain the admiration of Mao Zedong. Here is the photo of her with Chairman Mao and Chinese revolutionary leaders and the renowned African-American scholar W.E.B. Du Bois in 1959. She died there, living in China, in 1970 at the age of 85, having written more than 30 books based on her international journalistic work. And now we have a treat for you. Ruby Bishop, the legendary jazz singer and pianist, was born Ruby Carol Cogwell in 1919 in the town of Rochester in Thurston County. So that's just a little south of Olympia, among other Black pioneer families. The noted businessman, African-American businessman George Washington, was the founder of the city of Centralia. She was the eighth child and worked on the family farm, and dancing for country fairs at age five, and mostly self-taught on a piano, she led the Centralia Buccaneers Band at the age of 12. After graduating from high school, her parents sent her to the University of Washington, where they hoped that she would be trained as a pharmacist. But within a year, she left the university and her pharmacy career to start her music career. Settling in Seattle in the 1930s, Bishop played solo gigs at many of Seattle's well-known jazz venues. One of her big influences was the piano player Fats Waller, who invented the stride piano, a kind of ragtime style. And that song that you heard there was in this stride piano ragtime style. And because of restrictions imposed by the White Musicians Union, Black performers were limited to the south part of downtown around Jackson Street. And this restricted area was where the touring jazz greats could stay, perform, and hang out. Over the years, Bishop befriended and hosted many of these performers who look forward to, in addition to her music, home-cooked meal. And these greats included Duke Ellington, Cab Calloway, and especially Louis Armstrong, whom she often escorted about town when he played in Seattle. Although she didn't become a pharmacist, she married a druggist, Alex Bishop. Some of you might remember the early days in the International District where Bishop Drugs was a very friendly community business. And during World War II, like many women in her era, she became a Boeing B-17 mechanic and draftsman. Then after the war, she learned stenotyping. Remember what that is? In preparation for becoming a court reporter. Then she studied to be a beautician. She held many jobs to support the family. However, she always looked to her nighttime music career as her main profession. Over time, others recognized her musical ability. By the time she was nearly in her 50s, Bishop had achieved enough prominence to be recruited by the U.S. Army to entertain GI troops stationed in South Korea and South Vietnam. By this point, she had also performed before audiences in London, Paris, and Stockholm. Despite that success, Bishop viewed Seattle as her home, and by the mid-1970s, both national and international travel became less frequent. After her first husband died, Ruby Bishop married a second time at the age of 82, and she still has 8 grandchildren around our area. After that husband died, she returned to performing regularly at Vito's Lounge, the restaurant and bar on Madison Street, and she earned a spot in the Seattle Jazz Hall of Fame in 2016, and she would have been 100 years old this year, but sadly she passed away last year at the age of 99. So, next slide. Yeah, so here are some questions. What does it mean to be a feminist 100 years ago and now? And what barriers for women still exist? It is impossible to decide on a single definition for feminism because a woman's struggle to find a place in the world is rooted in and reflective of her own experience. And the last slide. What can feminism mean for women in different cultural communities? What are different priorities and different barriers? And what common goals can diverse women work on together? And here's a photo of the great Black women firefighters in the city of New York. So thank you so much, all of you, for attending. And I hope that you have questions. And I think you enter them into the chat. But we'll just go ahead and go back through all the slides to the beginning. So thank you. Okay.
So yes, we do have some questions already. From Carol, we have this question. These women, each undiscovered feminist, were trailblazers in each of their personal and professional endeavors. Do you have any sense or could imagine where in Seattle their paths may have crossed? What might that have looked like?
Well, they were at different times. That's number one. And number two, I think racial and ethnic communities were pretty separated in the early days. For example, the International District in Japantown, Chinatown were sequestered because of redlining, as well as the African American community in the central area sequestered because of redlining. So, of course, that affected their ability to gain real estate in other parts of the city. But in terms of their paths crossing, it's possible that they would have heard about each other. But if you notice the timing of when they died and the fact that they were traveling, I mean, Anna Louise Strong was in China, and Imogene Cunningham spent her latter years in San Francisco, and Priscilla Chongju was in Seattle, Ruby Bishop was in Seattle, and Vi Hilbert was in Seattle. In fact, Seattle University just named a very nice new building after Vi Hilbert. So I'm not sure where their paths would have crossed. I mean, it would depend on whether they were interested in the other fields of endeavor than their own.
We have another question here from Iona. Were women oppressed within the creative industry? If so, to what extent?
You mean, did you say oppressed?
Yes, oppressed.
Okay. Well, I think that you have to accept the fact that men were considered the leaders. They were nominally named as the heads of artistic organizations, and they were more often the ones that were shown in the museums and galleries and art shows and so on. If you look at the early years of the Seattle Art Museum,
They had the annual art exhibition. You'll find very, very few women were represented there. For example, Hilmi Juvonen was one of the notable few women shown in those years. And as well, I did note that Fei Chong, the husband of Priscilla Chong, was an organizer of the International District Art Shows, which were actually multicultural. They were not just Asian. They included, for example, the wonderful African-American sculptor James Washington Jr. But basically, I'm sure that they were 99% men. So there was that. In the case of Anna Louise Strong and also Cunningham, I think that they were outstanding in their fields and they stood up to any male discrimination or female discrimination that was going on. Anna Louise Strong, of course, traveled, and she was a very strong socialist and writer. She lived her later years in the socialist countries. She was accepted in Russia and China as an expert and leader in her field. And I have to say that Cunningham, living her later years in San Francisco, was very well known, although I know that she was not wealthy for all of the extensive skills that she had. She was quite good friends with other artists, and I know that if you have studied the work of Ruth Asawa, the sculptor who worked in made beautiful wire sculptures, you will see that Cunningham took a lot of the great photos of Ruth Asawa. So I know that in the case of Imogene Cunningham, she definitely knew and worked with a lot of the women artists in the Bay Area, in San Francisco. So anyway, thanks for the question, Iona.
Well, Iona had a second question. Imogene Cunningham had also taken pictures of Frida Kahlo. Was there a network among women who advocated for women's rights and women's suffrage?
Well, I can't speak to that officially, but I would think that they admired each other, they knew about each other, they studied in the same way that we do today. We seek out the stories and the identities of outstanding women in our fields. And as I mentioned just now, Ruth Asawa, she was an outstanding Asian American woman artist of her time. So yes, I would think that it would be a mutual admiration society for Imogene Cunningham to go to Frida Kahlo and to take photographs there. Wonderful.
Jasmine asks, how did these women deal with the barriers of their time period?
Well, in the case of Imogene Cunningham, her husband wanted her to wait for him before she moved to New York to work for Vanity Fair magazine, and she said no, and she divorced him. Went to New York. She did her work. She later came back to the West Coast, but I think that they did their work. They moved on. Vi Hilbert was very, very hardworking and enterprising. If you noted, one of the things I said was that her first three books were published by the UW Press, and then after that she established her own press, her own publishing house called the Lushootseed Seed Press, in order to create the stream of publications that were so important amongst the Native American tribes. So there was a lot of self-determination in that. And in the case of Priscilla Chong Ju, she was a very creative, so she was a merchant. She ran the Chinese crafts goods store at the Puyallup Fair for 30 years. So she was very enterprising. But in her own work, she was quite active in the artistic communities. And she was a great supporter of the Wing Luke Asian Museum. So she just showed a lot of strength and gained support from community involvement. And one of the things I said about Priscilla was that she was really active in the university district parade, making costumes and floats. And so she was very much She and others here were very much part of communities and supportive of other artists in their communities.
Jasmine also has a follow-up question. How would you answer the questions that you posed to us?
Oh. Well, of course there are differences amongst the different national and ethnic communities of women. And you notice that I showed a grouping of Muslim women in one of my last slides. There are very, very strong and creative leaders amongst women in our own Muslim communities in Seattle. And I think that they are different. Their lives are different. I attended a really great conversation of female students from Cleveland High School who put up an exhibit of their artwork at the Columbia City Gallery in Seattle. And they mostly, for the most part, this whole group of teenage girls were wearing the hijab. And there were pointed questions from the audience like, how do you feel about wearing the hijab? And what kind of treatment do you think you get equal treatment within the home compared to your brothers and so on? And they very lovingly explained that they have great pride in their families, communities, and their religion. And they described how they did the cooking and cleaning up while their brothers were studying or playing computer games, but not with rancor. And I think that we in the audience have to come to a point of understanding that there are other kinds of women. There are other women from other understandings and backgrounds within the feminist movement. Maybe there is not a feminist movement. Maybe the representatives of communities of color within the feminist movement are more mainstream kind of women. But I think that there are great differences. And possibly the women of color in the feminist movement do not find personal empowerment as the number one issue to deal with, but rather perhaps health care or domestic violence or other issues could come to the fore. But I don't want to be the one to answer all those questions, and if somebody would wish to add to that, I would be really happy.
I do have another question here. If you had women to look forward in time, what's one bit of insight or advice you think they might give their modern counterparts? So what advice do you think they would have for us?
Mm-hmm. Well, I chose all of them because they were creative and hardworking. They were mindful of their families and communities, and they had a mind for international understanding and travel. I think they would say, work hard on your artwork, work hard on your writing, don't take no for an answer, don't be intimidated by male bosses or husbands or even sons, and continue to follow your own creative vision, which, I mean, that advice could come from somebody living today versus from any time in history, but we can see from their lives that they were such important pioneers and pathfinders. I just really enjoyed learning from them, so hopefully those messages came through.
I'd like to ask a question, if you don't mind, for myself. As a librarian, I'm always interested in the research process. How did you go about researching these five women? Were there any surprising resources you discovered or other discoveries?
Well, first of all, thanks for not asking the question, why did you choose these five women? because it's so hard to, you can't imagine how many different scenarios there were quite a few that I considered. And when I gave my first audition to Humanities Washington on this topic, you have to try out to be a speaker, they went, nope, that's too many. So I did limit myself to 5. And of course, I wanted to represent the communities of color, the women of color, within the arts and journalism. So research. If anyone is interested in following these lines of thought, of course, the History Link, the wonderful resource on online history resource, and also the Washington State Historical Society, which is based in Tacoma, and they have the really great museum there, the History Museum. They have an extensive archive of women's history. In fact, an interview with me talking about the 1976 State Women's Conference and National Women's Conference. They have a long oral history interview with me and many, many other women leaders, feminist leaders of that time. So the History Museum in Tacoma, they have a great website, lots of information. Also, MOHAI, the Museum of History and Industry, has a fantastic archive of photos. Fabulous. You would find such important and surprising photos of women leaders in the MOHAI archives. Also, I consulted the Wing Luke Asian Museum, and they were able to give me several leads and information and photographs, really indebted to them. And okay, I'm probably forgetting one off the top of my head, but nowadays you will find legitimate and meaningful information on Wikipedia and Google if you search for names of women, and then your own library, whether the local branch or the downtown branch, or if you're associated with the University of Washington or any of the other universities, of course you would have the resources of the university libraries, and they have very active loan systems. Oh, one more addendum. I have to say that I do not include at this point a Japanese American woman, but if you are searching for information about the history of Japanese American women, go to the Densho online encyclopedia. It is a fabulous compendium of over 1,000 articles, and I wrote 5 of them, about many, many different wonderful women and subjects within that within that category of Japanese American history. So that's just a few.
Those are excellent sources. Thank you. There's one final comment, it looks like, here from Cynthia. Anna Louise was also the founder of the cooperative Campers, which was later named the Washington Alpine Club. Ooh. So I'm not sure if you knew that, but I do remember that you mentioned she was a hiker.
Yeah, and she and also Imogene Cunningham were, and other women, were early mountain climbers. And in the case of Imogene, if you can visualize her hiking with these long skirts and carrying her camera equipment up the mountain. Anyway, it's great. Yes, there were lots of women hikers of the early years, so thank you for that.
Well, that looks like that's all the questions we have. So, and we're right up onto the hour, so I think that's perfect timing.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for having me. And no one asked me about my future research plans, but I'll go ahead.
Yeah. Fill us in.
Okay. I'll just go ahead and tell you that I have been, over the last couple of years, been working on a research study about my grandmother, who is, this is on my mother's side, her mother. So my grandmother was an entrepreneurial woman of that period, the 1920s, in Los Angeles, and she had a restaurant. Then she went on to be a store shop runner in Tule Lake Camp, where they were incarcerated in prison during World War II, and then in Sacramento, restaurant and store owner. So she was quite a pioneer in the merchant area. And then my mother was one of the founders of a bunch of Asian American arts in Seattle. So just to tell you that, I'm studying about the Kibei women, who are the women that were born in the U.S., raised in Japan, and then came back to the U.S., and what their lives were like as Japanese American women who were raised in Japan but fully citizens. So I'll be working on that and giving talks on that in the next year or 2 years. That is it.
Wonderful.
So thank you for having me and for attending, everybody.
Yes, and I will just reiterate that this session has been recorded, so we will be posting it on the library's YouTube channel at some point in the future. And thank you so much, Mayumi. That was a really interesting presentation. Great conversation, great questions. Thank you. And I also will tell people that once we close out the session, audience members will be taken to an online survey from Humanities Washington, and your feedback is very much appreciated. Thanks again to our sponsor, Humanities Washington, and of course, thank you to all of you in the audience for joining us today. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Okay, thank you.